more effective in local populations. The first is by climate change itself. This is very obvious for you to see in regions like the Arctic and Pacific, where ice is melting and sea level is rising, and indigenous communities are having to actually relocate in the places that they live because of climate change. They're becoming, you know, climate refugees. And how that's, when you think about that, you think about when that happens to a culture, indigenous culture is based and made up. Language, ceremonies are made specifically from the place where these people live, and what happens when you have to move away and these people have to move the populations. It also brings up very important questions like who should pay for these things, whose fault is it, where are they going to go? These are the things that we need to start thinking about. In my home community, as I said, I'm from the Navajo reservation, we have about 250,000 Navajos in the United States. Half of them live on our reservation. Our reservation is 27,000 square miles, which is the size of France. It is the largest reservation in the United States. People there are ranchers and farmers, and the language is very strong. People farm, people haul there. People don't have electricity, they are still. Unemployment on our reservation is 50% before any economic crisis. So that's, I just wanted to give you a sense of how we live. The number one source of money that comes into our reservation is from coal mining. Coal mining is our number one source of income on our reservation. We also have a little gas development on our reservation, and we also have a history of uranium mining on our reservation, as well as several coal-fired power plants and timber extraction was the first resource that they took from our reservation. And that's the kind of situation that a lot of indigenous people are in North America. Over 35% of fossil fuels in the United States are on Indian reservations. And over 87% of all uranium in the United States are on indigenous reservations. So a lot of our communities are in this position that we're sick from these things. You know, people, populations have very high rates of cancer, high rates of asthma, skin diseases, respiratory illness, because of all this pollution that's being put and targeted on us. And we were put in that situation by very intentional policies of the U.S. government that started way back from colonization, that this is the only source of income that we can depend on, and the only source of livelihood that we can depend on is one that causes us to be sick. We're in a situation where, as I said, this is our number one source of income. So if you really think about it, and if you understand that indigenous culture is based on respecting the environment and living with the environment, then we're in a situation right now where we're economically dependent on our own cultural destruction. And when I talk about environmental justice and climate justice, it means breaking that, you know, that our livelihoods don't have to depend on polluting our environment and ruining our culture. You know what I'm saying? So that's the kind of situation that we're in. We're obviously affected by the issue of climate change because the cause of climate change predominantly is the burning of fossil fuels. And I told you how much we're affected by fossil fuels in our homelands. We're also affected by a lot of the solutions to climate change, negatively affected by a lot of the solutions to climate change. In the United States, our energy policy, you guys have all probably heard what we've committed to here in Copenhagen, 4% reductions of emissions by 2020, when what's really needed from our country is 95% reduction by 2050. Besides that, our energy policy in the United States gives billions of dollars to the coal industry as it stands, because they want to do research on clean coal technology, carbon capture and sequestration. Our energy policy promotes nuclear energy on our reservation. My reservation has banned uranium because we had uranium mining 50 years ago. It caused so many of us to be sick, and our Navajo Nation has banned it. However, all around our reservation, there's nuclear booming in the United States because people are considering nuclear power a solution to climate change. Not only is our targets in the United States very low, but Obama wants to reach all of that through offsets somewhere else. So he wants to pay some other project to go happen somewhere else so that we can keep on polluting here, keep on polluting in the United States. And that affects our communities negatively because it almost legitimizes that we can, that we have to house these unsustainable developments more and more and more and more. It's business as usual for our communities in North America. We're still getting sick. And besides that, a lot of, there's even more proposals for more mining. So it's a very bad situation for us. In the United States, there's no political pressure for real solutions to climate change, is my opinion. And I think that any solution to climate change that's being proposed in the United States is coming from a corporate agenda of greenwashing. In the United States, we've been told three main lies. The first lie is that we can buy our way out of climate change. So you see people in the United States buying green things, putting a little extra money on their plant tickets, they can offset their emissions. They think that they can buy their way out of this problem. The second lie that we've been told in the United States is that we don't have to change our lifestyle to solve climate change. And that is also a lie. The third lie that we've been told is that there's no other solution to climate change besides nuclear, besides clean coal, besides offsetting. And that's predominantly what a lot of people in the United States, and even the environmentally minded folks, are stuck in this kind of greenwashing of the issue. So our job, I feel, moving forward as Indigenous people and non-Indigenous people in the United States is to create that political pressure to take the conversation beyond just greenwashing. No one in the United States talks about consumption at all. Obama definitely doesn't. Obama has said that he wants to maintain our lifestyle in the United States while simultaneously solving climate change, and that's just not possible. So, what we need to do, one of the things that we need to do is to support those communities that we come from that are working very hard on the front lines to stop new coal developments, to stop new coal-fired power plants, to stop new uranium mining, to stop new nuclear reactors, to stop the toxins, to stop oil development, to stop oil pipelines. That's the most important thing that we can do. We need to stop using fossil fuels. And that will force our government to start looking at new things like renewable energy. We have so much renewable energy potential in the United States and on indigenous lands as well. In the plain states, there's over about 535 billion kilowatt hours a year of wind power generation potential, which is enough to provide energy for the majority of the United States. And in the Southwest, there's 17 trillion kilowatt hours a year of solar potential. And we need to make sure that those things happen. In terms of connecting to the international level, what I really want to see in this next year is a very strong international campaign against the carbon market. I understand that a lot of people in civil society who have been here have position against the carbon market, but I think we really need to push that even more and just let people know that it's a false solution. Actually, like, we are targeting campaigns all over the world to end the carbon market. And I think my time is up. So I just want to say thank you guys all for coming and listening. I hope you learned a little bit about what I said. And thanks for being here. I've had a really good time in Denmark, so thanks.
Yeah.